And now there it went. This will be fun. Hello, welcome to Broadly Speaking. Thank you so much for coming out tonight. This is a show where we tell some jokes, tell some stories, and play a game the contestant is destined to lose.
All to help someone who's helping someone else. Tonight's show benefits the benefits the Aviva Residential Program at the Wallace Annenberg Center. It's a facility that helps teen girls who've been abused and abandoned find a safe place to stay and intensive therapy.
It also happens to be a place where Jill and I have volunteered together for the last year and a half, which is why Jill kindly agreed to co-host with me here this evening. So thank you so much for being here, Jill.
My pleasure.
So I've been thinking about how to describe this show to people, the structure of the show, in a way that sticks.
Well, right, because we not only feature these great organizations that help women and girls, but we want to point out to the audience ways that they can get involved with these causes as well.
Exactly. And so if there's a cause you care about, there are basically three things you can do. You can speak, act, or give, which is what we do in the show. We speak, act, and give. So what do you think? It spells out SAG.
It does. But you know, that acronym is already in pretty heavy use, especially in this town.
That is true, yes. If you speak or act, you have to give them a lot of money. So, okay, what if we tweak the acronym? It could be like, speak up, take action, donate, ST.
No.
Heard it as soon as I said it. Acronym is also already in heavy use, especially in this town. All right, well, what if there's like a common modifier? Like, speak up, act up, give.
Nope, again.
Also. Well, there must be something.
Well, there is something.
Great. What?
Something. Something, something, something.
I feel like I'm in an Abbott and Costello routine.
If there's a cause you care about, there are three ways you can help. You can say something, do something, or give something.
Oh, hey, that totally works. Say something, do something, give something, and that's what we do in the show. We say something, do something, give something. Say, that's really something.
Later in the show, Maury Sterling is going to come on and give something to Aviva, which is helping to do something to help teenage girls who are at risk. But right now, we have a hilarious woman who is going to say something about being a teenage girl, or any kind of girl, or a woman, which carries inherent risks at any age.
You may have seen her on America's Got Talent, or Comics Unleashed, or How to Be a Grown-Up. She has performed stand-up all over the world, including for the troops in Afghanistan. We are thrilled to have her here this evening. Please give it up for the one, the only, Jodi. Yes! Aviva!
I just love that name. It's like my favorite name. I just want to like yell it. Aviva! Doesn't it sound powerful? It does, right? I feel like I would just scream that everywhere. I love it. This is so great. Please keep it going for Kate and Jill and everybody involved in this. I'm so happy to be here. When I found out about this this organization and what they do, and I went on the website and read about it, it was inspiring. You know, taking in, you know, teenage girls at risk, you know, teaching them stuff, getting them ready for, it was so, I'm going to open a home for single women over 40. Cats are welcome, of course. I will be there. I feel like I need that, you know what I mean? And then if somebody wants to foster me, that's fine too. Even though I am looking for a forever home, I think, I feel like it could work, especially the classes on compassion and empathy. I feel like I have a lot of friends that actually need that fucking class. I was reading a lot about the website, on the website too, about Aviva. The name in 1927 was actually changed from Hamburger Home. That was the name, right? It was called Hamburger Home, named after, I guess, the benefactor of it. I guess that's what it was called, Hamburger Home, but it was for single, working, Jewish female, okay? Which is me, exactly. I'm a hamburger, basically. Not a cheeseburger, because that's not kosher, okay? I can't believe they went with Hamburger Home. I was reading, I was like, what, really? Somebody was like, yeah, we should just go with Hamburger Home. Like, they couldn't come up with anything else more creative. I hope that the guy who gave them the money actually owned a hamburger place, because that would be weird if he didn't. So this name is much better. It's the second best name change since Prince went back to Prince, in my opinion. Right? Isn't it? Teenage girls. I'm so happy that I'm not one anymore. I remember my mom used to threaten me all the time. She's just waiting until you get older, and then you have a daughter. And she's a teenager. I'm like, all right, stop threatening me, bitch. I don't know what you're doing. I get it. I'm a terrible person. I'm a teenage girl. That's what we do. And then I realized that actually, I don't think women actually grow out of it. This is what I realized about women. Teenagers, adults, we just give angry compliments, too. Like, all the time. I just noticed that with all of my, especially in Los Angeles. They're always very aggressive compliments that girls give. Like, oh my god, are you losing weight? What's up? Are you okay? What's happening with you? Is that a new shirt? When did you buy that? It's so weird. So God bless anybody that works with teenage girls is what I'm saying, anywhere in the world. Oh my god, it's amazing. I was surrounded by a lot of children on America's Got Talent too. I don't know if anybody watches that show. It's a very family heavy show, and there's a lot of kids on that show. That show actually made me strangely competitive with children. That's the weird thing. You know what I mean? Like, because there's $1 million at stake. Because a 10-year-old came flying up to me backstage. She was like, this is my dream. This is all I've ever wanted. My entire life. It's my dream. I need this. I'm like, I'm sorry. You haven't even gotten your period yet. Okay? Like, I sit at home mouth kissing my cat. I need this. That show also is like, when you're on a show like that too, it's a weird thing because they broadcast your real age, which is unacceptable, in my opinion. And I'm proud of my age, I am, but they led with it, with any kind of recap or interview. They're like, 42-year-old comedian Jodi, come over here, 42-year-old comedian, help her, she's 42, help her over here, let's go. Her eggs are dropping out of her ovaries, pick them up, let's go. That's a weird feeling. I would love to actually, volunteer. I teach stand-up to at-risk middle school students, and this would be something that I'd love to volunteer with these girls. I think it's important, especially to give them like some better role models than some of the women that I've grown up with. Just take Disney princesses, for example, seriously. I mean, I think Cinderella is the only one who actually had to work for her man, you know what I mean? Look at like Snow White and Sleeping Beauty. All those bitches had to do to find a man was wake up. That's it. I'll look at a husband. That was easy. It's not fair. I mean, I have been single my whole life. I feel like I can help these girls too. Teach them it's okay when you grow up. Get a career. Find yourself. I've been doing it my whole life. But when you're in your 20s, you're actually... It's funny because people celebrate a single girl in their 20s. They call them smart. They're like, oh my god, look at you, you smart girl playing the field, not settling down. Good for you, you smarty smart pants. Then when I was single in my 30s, I was just called strong. That's it. Everyone's like, oh, I'm still single. Well, you're strong. I mean, you're really hanging on. You're just white knuckling it, you know? You're solid like a rock, because for you. And now that I'm single in my 40s, I'm just spiritual. That's it. I'm like, have you seen Jodi? She's super centered. She really... She knows how to breathe. She's comfortable in her own skin, even though it's older. Good for her. It's very strange. I also feel like I think with Aviva, I could help these girls, help mold them and teach them how to manifest their destiny. I mean, I haven't been able to do it yet, but I feel like I can help them do it. That shit's a lot of work, manifesting. Have you guys realized that? The breathing and the meditating and the visualizing and the writing in the journals. And, oh my god, vision boards. Or for anyone under 30, I'm sure the teenage girls just call it Pinterest. I think that's what they would call it. That's it. I've ever since I was a young girl, would just put pictures everywhere. I have so many pictures all over my house, I don't even know what I've asked for at this point. I'm like, why is there a picture of a pig in my fridge? Like, did I want a pet pig at one point? Did I run out of bacon? Did I have sex with a guy who squeals? Nobody knows what I'm saying. I don't know. I haven't figured life out. That's why I think I need a home for women over 40. I'm going to come move into it. I think I need to. I have so many self-help books. I'm so scared that if I die, someone's going to find my Kindle and be like, wow, this chick was screwed up. Seriously. I like every book, like The Secret, The Secret 2, The Secret and The Secret, What the Hell's the Secret, How to Get What You Want and What You Have, and my favorite, How to Get What You Want by Taking It from Someone Else, Without Them Knowing That You Took It. That's a good one. I also like every dating book too, like all dating books, like he's just nothing into you, you're just nothing into him, he's physically inside of you and still nothing into you. I don't like those books! I would get better advice. I feel like I would to teenage girls. I would. Oh, God. I feel like more things should be geared towards women, especially like movies too. I always look at the movies that are coming out, the Transformers and the G.I. Joes, Avengers, everything is like geared towards like things that boys played with. Boys. I want to see movies that represent the toys that us girls played with. Like, I want to see next summer from Fox and Hasbro comes a story about a girl and her oven. How about that? I want to see Transformers 4 Rise of the Easy Bake Oven. Yeah, right? Cook the shit out of them with that 3-watt light bulb. That's what we're doing. A 3-watt light bulb. That's what they put in those ovens. Do you guys remember having them? You can, like, light a caterpillar on fire with a magnifying glass faster than you can cook one of those dumb cakes. Remember you put it in there, the batter, 7 hours later, the shit would not be done? And you're like, well, I got it. No, don't put your hand in the oven! And finally just take the uncooked batter and was like, I'm drinking it, I don't care. I'll just drink it. It's a milkshake. It's what it is. You know, it's funny, when I told all my friends that I was, doing this amazing benefit, they're like, teenage girls, I would see teenage boys because I'm a cougar, so that's creepy. I'm actually Jewish, so I'm a Jewger, really, actually. Means I like to hook up with young guys, but I have a lot of guilt about that, okay? I mean, not enough to stop, obviously. I just believe in our country's motto, no child left behind. That's my motto, too. Thank you. It's so weird, too. I don't even know what the age of a cougar. So many people use that term, they just throw it around. I was at a Starbucks, I heard these two girls talking. These two young girls are like, oh my god, I can do this guy last night, he's 23, and I'm 26. I'm a total cougar. Like, I'm sorry, if you're a cougar, then what the hell am I? A saber-toothed tiger? It's so weird. Something else I think I would help with these girls is, social media is just ridiculous to me. It gets out of hand, especially naked pics. I can't even, it's ridiculous. There was a guy that I was dating, I was hooking up with a 25-year-old, which was strange. It was going as well as it can go for that. And then he sent me a text that said, where have you been all my life? That's what the 25-year-old asked me. Where have you been all my life? I'm like, well, let's see. When you were born, I was a senior in high school. And then guess what? He sent me a picture of a naked junk shot. That's what they do, these kids today. Guys and girls. It's ridiculous, because I didn't grow up in that time. I want it to come to an end. Mainly because it scares the crap out of us, okay? Because we never know when that's coming. And to me, it's almost like guys are just shocked in the morning when they wake up and it's still there, so they have to document it and send it to every girl they know. Like, oh my god, there it is again! Snap, happy Tuesday, ladies. Like, it's so weird. It makes me think, like, what did guys do before camera phones? You know what I mean? Like, I imagine some guy in the 80s and 90s just staring at himself like, yeah! She could see it now. She'd be right over, obviously. Quick, get the Polaroid and a stamp. Which should actually be a great letter. Like, if anybody ever wants to do that, I would just say go old school. But do it with a Polaroid and only, like, half develop it when you mail it. So girls are like, oh my god, what is it? I don't know. Oh my god. Oh, well, that's going on my vision board. That's where that is. But more importantly, I would tell girls to never send one. I can't even, to me it's ridiculous. I would never do that. I mean, I'd say that, although I have, so I would never do it again. It's bizarre to me. Like, I need like hair and makeup and a lighting crew and a wind fan, you know what I mean? Like the one time that I did it for this 25-year-old, I had to set the timer up on my iPad for a 5-second delay. And which is worse, because now you're standing there naked for 5 seconds trying to figure out what you think is sexy. You're like, 5, 4, 3, 2, there it is, that's it. Just hot, sexy. And I try like every pose and I'm deleting and filtering. I finally send it, he shoots back, he's like, hot, send another. I'm like, I don't have another day to waste. That took 12 hours, oh my god. I love doing benefits. I do a lot of them. It's always great to give back to anybody that, you know, that needs it. And I actually have been trying to get pregnant. Last year I did the entire year, 5 rounds of IUI. And it's amazing, but I did it the right way though, don't get me wrong. Before each insemination, I went out and I got drunk. I mean, like super wasted, because I wanted it to be natural, obviously, so. Yeah, fingers crossed, well, maybe tonight. My donor's Italian and Irish, which basically means I'm gonna be loud and drunk, and I'm okay with that, actually. But honestly, the doctor was very funny. I actually did a benefit for them, their Christmas benefit for women that were trying to get pregnant as well, because it's a lot of money. But the doctor, because he knew I was a comedian, so he liked to mess with me. Before the first insemination, I kid you not, I am in the stirrups, sitting in there, and he walks in the room and goes, okay, I've got the horse sperm, get the horse, I'm just kidding, we're not using horse sperm. And I go, I'm sorry, are you kidding? If I gave birth to a centaur, do you know how famous I would be? I'd get my own show for sure. Can you make that shit happen? I mean, assuming I survived the childbirth, because that actually sounds painful. But then think about it, I'd have like a half little boy, half horse that I could ride to the comedy clubs in LA traffic. I'm gonna take mama to work on today. Think about those bragging rights. Be like, oh, your son is on the honor roll? My son just won the Kentucky Derby. Still a hope of mine, but I don't have a baby, but I do have a cat. It's obvious that I have a cat. I don't even need to say it. It was actually my fear when I turned 40 and I was still single that I would open the door and just a pack of cats would come running in. Like, give up, we're here, it's okay. It's all right, Jodi, you can give up now. I actually, it's like my version of The Bachelorette, 25 cats just come fucking running in. Yeah. You know, it's funny because guys, it's you typically that don't like. You guys don't like cats, typically. And I don't understand why you don't like cats, because you're exactly like a cat. Okay, girls are like dogs. Okay, we've been conditioned to think that men are like dogs, and women are like cats. But this could be further from the truth. Guys, you're like cats, you're aloof and emotionally unavailable. Women are exactly like dogs. We're exactly like dogs. We're like, hey, where you going? 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 Can I go? Can I go? Can I go? Can I go? Can I? I'm gonna wait right here. 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 Shoes. So guys, you're like cats. You're like, oh, you're home. Okay, so this is what's gonna happen. You're gonna feed me. Then I'm gonna stare out the window at nothing. Then I'm gonna pass out in the bathroom. Deal? Is that a deal? Women are like dogs. We clean up after ourselves. You ever see a dog vomit? Eats that crap right back up. Yeah, it usually does it real quick. You don't even know what's happened. But guys are like cats. You'll puke anywhere and make a huge scene about it. You're like, ha! 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 And then you're like, oh God, can you clean that up? It's so gross. I don't want to touch it. Here comes the dog. I got it. Women are like dogs. We need to be groomed. Shampoo, condition, blow dry, fluffy. Guys are like cats. Like, what? I'm dirty? Oh, I'm dead. I'm ready. Let's go. What is going on? My name is Jodi Miller. Thank you guys so much. Please keep supporting Aviva!
To the do something portion of our show.
So, as we mentioned at the top of the show, tonight's featured organization is particularly meaningful to us because Jill and I have been doing something there for the last year and a half. So actually, Jill, why don't you start by saying what the residential facility at Aviva is?
Well, 36 adolescent girls reside at Aviva full time. The majority of them are coming from environments where they have been abused or abandoned or both, so they may be feeling angry or depressed or hopeless, and Aviva provides them a structured environment and a treatment model that includes art and movement therapy, independent living classes, and self-esteem programs.
So if any of you know or have ever worked with any kids from circumstances like these, you might think that for even one of these girls to have a chance at success, she would need to be surrounded by a village of teachers, therapists, social workers, lawyers, volunteers, and mentors, and a cornucopia of other individuals willing to give even half a care at least part of the time. And even then, she would have to be someone of great inner fortitude and resolve with above average intelligence and unwavering attitude towards reshaping her own destiny. And you may think that because it's true.
So where do you start? Well, tonight, let's start by watching a video, and we'll let the girls at Aviva tell you in their own words what life is like for them.
Take a look.
The black side, it's representing, you know, my past. My past is kind of like dark, you know. I have the gun. It's representing my crime that I'm here for in Aviva. The F, my grades in school, all the times that I've been to jail, the drugs and stuff, drinking I used to do. The heart, you know, it's in the red of the wine. It's like representing like kind of like a broken heart.
make me see a whole new way. Make me see the new day, the new day, the new day.
I was in the third grade when I started getting into trouble. When I was about 2 years old.
So I was 12, 14, and 15?
12, 13.
The judge sentenced me to juvenile hall because of my behavior.
Like, you do not want to go to juvenile hall.
It was horrible. I was 12. It was for assault battery.
I was sent to jail and stayed there for 3 months till Aviva came to pick me up.
I was scared. It took me a while to know I had support, but I did. I was 15 when my dad passed away. I had not really ever talked to anybody about it. Through certain arts that we do, I got to let out feelings about my dad. I have the gates of heaven. I wanted to think of a place where my dad would be. I wanted him to be there, so if I asked for him, at least I'd know where he was at. So, I made heaven a box.
When I first came here, I didn't want to talk to anybody. I didn't want to talk to any therapist. I didn't want to have nothing to do with it. I didn't trust them.
I felt like I was just in another gem that I had to get out of. You get a lot of one-on-one attention.
They just pump you up, you know, like, you know, you're doing good, you know, keep up the good work. And, you know, that helps me a lot because that's, you know, somebody's noticing, you know, I didn't have that at home. Rules were good for me. I needed that, having to answer to a structural thing. And I liked it. This side, it's supposed to be, you know, how I am now and how I've changed. You know, here am I having my family that has been there, you know, throughout this whole thing. My family supports me, teachers, you know, staff. I really didn't like myself, you know. That's the thing where it comes all down to, you know, you don't like yourself and you don't want to show it, so you embarrass other people, make fun of other people. Nah, you know, like I said, I love myself. I make my parents proud of me. You know, Aviva has, you know, changed my life tremendously.
They've helped me in ways I can't even understand. They've helped me emotionally, physically, mentally.
Better relationships with people, more trust.
How to move on, to not stick to the past, you know.
No more fear, and believing I can do things.
Aviva has changed my life. We grew a bond that you couldn't break.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the volunteer coordinator for Aviva, Elizabeth Rulon.
Maybe you could start us off by just telling us a little bit more about who the girls at Aviva are and the circumstances that bring them to you and what kind of services you can provide once they arrive.
Yeah, absolutely. The girls that come to Aviva come through one of two doors. We've got the kids who come through the Department of Child and Family Services, DCFS, and the girls who come through the Department of Probation. Both these groups of kids have been removed from their homes by the court system for some severe circumstance, abuse, neglect, abandonment. They've all gone through these experiences, and we find that that's kind of a common denominator among them. Like, the girls who come through probation come because they've committed some kind of petty theft or crime, and the girls who come through DCFS come because somebody found out that they were being abused and neglected and made it known. But it's the same population underneath. It's just the different ways it was discovered. So as far as services we offer a 24-hour, 24/7 residential care for these girls. They come and they live in a structured environment. we offer them a home. It's a place for them to live and for them to start that healing process and that growth process. And yeah, just get used to a start to begin the process of living a different life.
Well, that's what one of the things we wanted to talk to you about, because there's a quote from Hillary Clinton that I love that is, talent is everywhere, but opportunity is not. Mm-hmm. And certainly we've seen that in our experiences with the girls in Aviva, not just them not having had opportunities that a lot of kids have, but them not knowing what other opportunities exist in the world in terms of education and careers and just basic day-to-day lifestyles, different, that there are different ways to be. So how do you go about exposing them to these things that they haven't seen modeled in their own lives?
Something that's really interesting is that a lot of the girls, when they come in, they either have no idea what they want to be because no one's ever asked them, or they want to be probation officers.
I remember being told that when I took the tour, and just being floored by that.
Because that's what they know. That's like the professional career that they've been exposed to. So from the time they get there, we start them in a program called ILS, Independent Living Skills, to teach them basics of life, how to have a budget, how to open a bank account, how to pay your bills, things like that. And then also, too, we really rely heavily on volunteers to help expand their worlds and offer them these different experiences that get them thinking about, gosh, what do I want to do with my life? We've had a group come in called Youth in Action Film Collaboration that brought in 60 volunteers, producers, writers, directors, and they created this film project with the girls and screened it at Sony, and you know, the girls felt like $1 million, and we had girls from that wanted to pursue a film career in some aspect. We are working with Relativity Media right now, and they're scholarshiping a couple of our girls for their summer program. So we work with so many volunteers that have so many life experiences, and some of them, you know, sponsor outings, put on workshops, help the girls, you know, expand their world through trips to museums, trips to Griffith Park, these kinds of things, just push their horizons.
I think to speak to even the flip side of that, you know, obviously for Aviva to fulfill its mission, you have to appeal to people outside of the kind of communities these girls come from. And for people who haven't had to entirely transform their lives and learn an entirely new set of skills, behavior, cultural norms and rules, sometimes there can be a lack of empathy as to what it takes for these girls, and also a lack of understanding as to why not every girl just greets you with open arms and joy and gratitude for all that you're offering them. So how do you help people who haven't come from that experience understand the perspective that the girls are coming from?
That is a great question, and this is my... something that I brought along just to help people.
If you were wondering.
Yeah, well, she brought us a gift of trash.
I brought this along as a tool to help you put yourself in the mindset of these girls. When these girls arrive at our doorstep, everything they own is in a garbage bag with them. Maybe it's one or two garbage bags. Maybe they arrive with the clothes on their back. But imagine if that was your world. If everything you owned fit in one garbage bag, and the fight or flight instincts that would go with that to protect these few things that you have. And so for us to bring them into this environment where that's the world as they've known it, and to tell them, here's all this new stuff that we're offering you.
Trust us, it's great.
Yeah, it's and a number of these kids too have been bounced from one placement to the next. They're all foster kids. They've all been removed by the court system. So it's this whole new structure and talking about things that may be hard or hurtful. And, you know, they're 15, 16 years old. Like, that's...
Yeah, they're starting with teenagers.
They're pleasant and welcoming group.
There's teenagers who've been through horrifying experiences that no one should ever have to go through, let alone as a child. And
have never had evidence to the contrary that this time will be different.
Yeah, exactly.
And you're saying no, seriously.
They don't know how long they're
going to
be there. You know, there's these caring people, but they could be, they could run away. They could be here today, gone tomorrow. Like, it's just, it's a really hard place for them. So.
Well, you were talking about the different sorts of volunteers and the different sorts of things we can expose the girls to. Kate and I teach improv and creative writing as part of the independent activities program at Aviva.
Uh-huh.
There are lots of other classes. Makeup and cooking, I know, are very popular. Sometimes
yes,
we are told by girls on their first day with us they would rather be in those classes.
So if you can do makeup or cook, you will be a hero.
But we always win over by the end.
By the end.
Yes.
By the end.
Okay. But what are some things that people can teach, and what is involved in signing up and getting started?
So signing up and getting started, you can talk to me after the show, or you can go on our website, www.avivacenter.org, and there's a volunteer section, and you start by downloading the application, and I call you after you've sent it in, and we go from there. But in terms of what you can teach, we've had everything under the sun. We've had cooking, comedy, acting, yoga, volleyball, basketball, beauty, arts and crafts, jewelry making. It's kind of a... Here's an example. We had a volunteer come in and said, I really want to teach an IA on French culture. We were like, okay, we'll try that. And she was so excited and so passionate about it and sharing the experience. She wasn't even French. And she
could have made it
she
up.
She brought
yeah.
in the food and talked about the culture and the language and all these things. And the girls got so into it. And so it's really a matter of bringing something that you are good at or passionate about or excited about and letting that be contagious and spread to the girls.
So obviously what we're trying to show with this show is that you can do good while having fun, and that's sort of what our volunteering is that we're having fun for
Absolutely.
An hour a week. But if somebody can't commit to a full 6-week course, are there other ways to volunteer that are less time?
Definitely. Tutoring is a big one. So something I've learned is that just through working at Aviva, it's a lot easier to pass a child through grades instead of holding them back. So we'll have girls come in that are 14 years old that should be in eighth grade or freshman in high school, but they're at a third grade reading level because they've just been passed along. So tutoring is really important and really, really helpful for our girls. Mentoring is huge, is hugely, hugely important, and it's something we take very, very seriously. We really look for adults that want to invest deeply in a child's life for about an hour in a week, whether it's meeting or on the phone or whatnot, but the hope is that that mentor would really commit to this child and continue with them after they move on from Aviva. Other opportunities, you can lead a one-day workshop. Girls love the beauty spa day type workshops or an outing, plan an outing for the kids. And then in a separate vein, we are also a fully licensed foster care and adoption agency. And
if you want to go the other way to the biggest time, to the biggest commitment
the largest
you can make.
Commitment.
Well, no, I wasn't actually going there.
Oh.
I was going to a lower commitment than that. Every 6 to 8 weeks, we have foster care parent trainings, and they bring all the kids. So the parents are being trained by the foster care staff, and we've got like 40 kids running around our administrative building, from toddler through young teens. So if you ever want to come out and play with a whole bunch of kids, it's a good opportunity. It really is fun, but we count on volunteers to play with them, read with them, hang out with them, take care of the babies. So
obviously we're shining a light on a lot of the wonderful things you're accomplishing at Aviva, but if we're being completely honest, not every girl who comes through Aviva is a success story. But I know what keeps you going, what keeps the rest of the staff going, are these girls who do choose a different path and do make a change. So are there things you see in common between the girls who use their time at Aviva to turn things around for themselves?
Definitely. And I've considered this before and thought about what's the difference between the girls who make it and slip back into former habits and not as great lifestyles. And two things that I've noticed among these girls that go on and break this cycle. One is that they have some sort of relationship with a caring adult, whether it's a family member, and there's some situations where, you know, mom's boyfriend was abusing the girl, mom decided, and the child was taken from the home, and mom decided she wanted to have that relationship with her child, so got rid of the boyfriend. And we call those, you know, if there's a family reunification plan, it might be another relative, or it might be a mentor that really makes a huge difference in one of these girls' lives. Or it might be a staff person. We have some amazing men and women who work with these girls. And our girls, the ones that make it and come back and visit are the ones who a lot of times have bonded with someone who has encouraged them and told them, hey, your life can be different. It doesn't have to be the way it's been up until now. And then the other thing that I see that these girls have in common is that they have some kind of aha moment where they realize that this really is an opportunity for them to turn things around, that they don't have to be the victim of their circumstances, that they can be survivors. And it takes different things for different kids. I've heard girls tell stories of, you know, lying in a cell in juvenile hall and realizing that is not what they wanted to, that's not how they wanted their life to look, because, you know, like that tends to lead towards jail after you're 18. So yeah, the adult relationships and the encouragement and that kind of maybe even being the catalyst for this moment of things can be different and I want that.
And I think it gets back to the idea that they have to have someone show them that there is an option.
Absolutely.
And because a lot of girls lie in that cell and think, I don't want this to be my life, I don't know what other option there is.
Absolutely.
And so it does take a village. Speaking of people for whom it's taken a village, we had a very interesting night tonight. And speaking of girls who have chosen a different path, we had a girl booked from Aviva to come here and speak about her experience. She opted not to come at the last minute. However, we had a girl coming who we also knew from Aviva to sit in the audience and enjoy the show. Hello.
She had previously been
in one of our classes, and so I called her foster mom and said, hey, do you think Kiana would want to come talk about Aviva on the show? She said, put her on the phone and ask her. And of course, Kiana said, I'm there for you, Kate, whatever you need. I love this girl so much, I can't even describe it. So she's here to be the representative of the resident of Aviva. So please give an extra super huge warm welcome to Kiana Watkins.
First of all, thank you so much for coming and being our shining example of goodness.
No problems.
Kiana is actually, she is our first repeat guest on Broadly Speaking, because she was in the first show we ever did performing stand-up here. She is the Regis Philbin of Broadly Speaking, just coming back over and over.
So without getting into anything personal or uncomfortable to talk about, can you tell us a little bit about what your time at Aviva meant for you?
So my time out of Aviva
was, I guess you can say, I guess every girl would say it was a lot different. And it's true, in the system, every case is different. Mine was especially different because I was there the longest than pretty much they've had in years. I was at Aviva, whereas most people stay 6 months or more, like 6 months to like 9 months. I was at Aviva for 2 years. And so I learned a lot there about myself, as well as, you know, kind of the ins and outs of how to work people.
Well, you kind of did, because, I mean, we talk about it takes a village and all the opportunities for an adult to come in. And, I mean, I've seen your village. I have been to parties hosted by your mentor filled with people who have all taken an interest in you and some time in you. And so I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about what it's like to be the recipient of that kind of attention, and if that had the effect that we all hope it has.
So that is crazy, to kind of grow up with this, you know, keeping watch over you. Like, this is what watches me at night. You know, you didn't have mommy and daddy and stuff like that. It's like, oh, it's not my sob story or whatever, but, you know, like, that's the thing. And then all of a sudden, you know, I used to, like, lay in bed at night and, like, make the wish on the star and, like, go into the tunnels and, like, do the little hold your breath and make a wish thing, and always wish for, like, regular parents. I just wanted regular parents and regular life. I got, like, 50. I made way too many wishes. Like, it's just, they were answered and then answered, and it was like sending the text, like pressing send too many times, and it just goes broop, 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 broop. I got so many people like have my back, and it's kind of ridiculous. It started out with one, and then it ended up with like 40.
But it also, I mean, these people wouldn't, you could have 50 parents, but if you're not receptive to what's being offered to you, you have something inside of you that says, I'm going to have a different life than what started out for me.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I've, being at Aviva, being in placement in general, growing up in placement and stuff, like, you can see the people who, you know, had it handed to them on a silver platter, could have easily picked, like, they were in a fork in the road, and, you know, just weren't ready for the help. And it's like, once you accept the help, then it's totally like, you know, smooth sailing. Once you ride the tide, it's okay. But, you know, everybody, sometimes, you know, there's a lot of estrogen and teenage hormones going on in the house.
There's a lot of estrogen.
So, like, sometimes, you know, a lot of the time, everybody was fighting against so much, and everything that came by was just kind of like, oh, well, I'm fighting against everything else. I don't know what that is. I'm just going to fight it.
Well, you had a mentor who, a friend of ours, Betsy, who, what? Is Betsy here? Oh, well, then never mind. We're going to point her out. She's going to stand up and do a babble, whatever. But Betsy, you had an interest in stand-up comedy. Betsy was a comedian, and she really gave you a lot of guidance and a lot of opportunities in that way. And that kind of, I feel like that was a big catalyst to opening up a lot of things for you. Is that true? Am I just making that up?
It's actually super true. To be honest, I didn't even know I liked stand-up comedy. I knew I liked to laugh, and I knew that I was...
Really? Interesting. Liked to laugh.
You mean?
Try to find that in other kids.
I knew I was a smartass. I knew that. Like, okay, teenage kids are smartasses. We all know this. But I'm ridiculous. Like, it's bad. And I don't know, I didn't know I liked comedy until I met Betsy, and then we went, well, you know, one thing led to another. Wait. Appropriately. And we ended up going to, like, I got opportunities to perform at, like, actual clubs. Like, I stood on the Laugh Factory stage and the Improv stage.
You have a show coming up at the Comedy Store, correct?
I do.
Do you know what date that is?
No.
We'll check with her mom after. I think, but I love that you say that, because I mean, I said earlier that you're going and having fun for an hour a week doing something you already love, and maybe you think that's not a big deal or that doesn't make a huge difference, but it may be the thing that somebody latches onto and says, this is the rope, you know? And I think it's just, I'm very glad you're here, and I love you, and I love your story.
So, you are no longer at Aviva, so can you tell us a little bit about where you are now, what you're doing, and then maybe what you're hoping is next?
Well, now, so I got to Aviva when I was 13, and I left last year, and now I'm 17. I just turned 17, like, last week.
Happy birthday!
And, I am... I've been doing a lot in theater. I go to Grand Arts, that real, like, you know, like Jesus's water slide thing.
Yeah.
And I'm doing a lot of theater. I'm directing a Tommy.
Wow.
And I've been doing a lot of acting and music. I'm up to 8 instruments now. Last time we saw each other, I was at 7.
I know.
What did you add?
Slacking off a little bit.
Sorry. What did you add?
I added bass, but like
it's all about the bass.
No trouble.
I'm sorry. I thought. And you, in the last year, you found a foster mom, or she found you, or you found each other.
Betsy knew it was my first public show, my first ever public show. And it was this weird place, and I was like, I don't know, I'm not gonna even explain it, not gonna go there. And Betsy knew the president of that place. And I didn't even remember seeing the person. That's cool. And so then, fast forward a year, and it gets to the point where Aviva's like, all right, kid, your social worker's not really doing much. Like, how do we help you? What are we gonna do? And I was so tired. I was so tired. Every day I would like stand up and just like, okay. You guys remember my flip-flops? I had these flip-flops with just, I called them my Jesus water walkers. Yeah, and they just showed how tired and just how long I'd been walking on the same ground forever.
They were just held together with tape and
they were held together with blue masking tape.
Yeah.
And it wasn't just like the little thing came out between my toes. They were like worn down. I was touching the floor. I was just like for how long have I been walking on the Aviva grounds? Like I was so over it. And so Betsy says, I'm gonna start looking for places for you. I'm gonna start helping. And so she goes, oh, I know someone. She just pulls a person out of her butt.
That is where I keep people as well.
It's good storage.
And
and so then she contacts my now foster mom and asks, well, you know, do you know anyone? You know, like not even like will you take her in, but do you know anyone? My foster mom's like, oh yeah, I'll take her in, of course. Like, yeah.
And can we acknowledge her here in the theater?
She's right here in the bright
right
green.
Here in thank you so much for being part of this show on literally 20 minutes notice. And Elizabeth, thank you so much for being here and talking to us about the reality of life at Aviva.
Oh, thank you for having me.
They are going to have a table set up in the lobby after the show, so if you have more questions or want to learn more about ways you can volunteer or help, please go check them out. But right now, please give them a huge round of applause for being here. Donations, that brings us to the give something portion of our show.
Yay! People are already excited.
Also known as the portion we call
The Game is Rigged. For
the mics are rigged.
For the girls at Aviva, it can often seem like the game is rigged against them because in many ways it is. Elizabeth and the rest of the staff are doing their part to help unrig the game, but we thought it might be fun to bring out someone who could help unrig it a little bit more.
So you may have seen tonight's guest bugging Claire Dane's home on Homeland, or showcasing Halle Berry's sonogram on Extant, or displaying his love of forensics on CSI, CSI New York, and CSI Miami, among many, many other impressive credits. But I think we all know him best as the voice of Wolfguard 3 in Kung Fu Panda 2. Please welcome to the stage, Mr. Maury Sterling.
You're welcome. Glad to be here. Hi.
Hi. So, we have been given to understand that you are actually active in the Big Brothers Big Sisters program, so you probably have a certain idea of what some of the girls at Aviva are facing as well.
A little bit, although I'm blown away. This is an awesome night. This is absolutely amazing. Thank you guys for being here, and thank you guys for doing this and hearing the stories. I'm moved. Gotta laugh here. I didn't know Jodi had my cake picture on her fridge. yes, not to draw focus from you, but yeah, I've been doing the big, I'm just going to talk, doing the Big Brother thing for, yeah, a little bit, so it's been getting to know some stories and stuff that's way outside of anything I ever knew about, and it's great to help, but yeah.
I have to ask you to try the other mic just because we're recording it, so,
oh, yeah.
Well, then, for the video that eight people on YouTube will watch, we need the...
How's this?
Yellow mic. Yeah.
Yellow mic.
Yellow mic.
Yeah. The yellow mic. All right, but you are a big brother, so you do participate in helping kids who maybe haven't had all the advantages in life
as
well.
Yeah, no, it's been amazing. I've been working with a guy for about a year and a half, Maddox. He's 10, he's lived through stuff that I can only imagine, and it's a great way to sort of just add another mentor figure place for him to go and have fun.
So, a lot of the girls we've met at Aviva believe that being a famous actor is the solution to all of their problems. That's their life plan.
It's the whole plan.
It's just the extent
be famous and
of the plan. You are what mythology refers to as a working actor, so I assume that everything goes right for you and you get everything you want from everyone all the time, always. Is that correct?
Yes, absolutely correct.
we'll let them know it's a good life plan. Okay.
It's a good life plan. Pills and it's a great life plan. My mom was really relieved the first time I got paid.
I bet you were too.
I was too. Yeah, they were both very supportive. But yeah, it's just dreamy. It's no problem. Flat, easy sailing, reliable, consistent.
Well, speaking of things that are dreamy, you are a newlywed. You just celebrated your first anniversary, right?
Yes.
And your wife, Alexis, is also in the mentoring game. She just launched a website for young girls, young women and girls, called Miss Matters. That's kind of an advice column website. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, it's called missmatters.com. She's an actor, producer. She wears a lot of hats and extremely talented and much smarter and more talented than I am. And she has been mentoring and tutoring a little bit. From that, she developed this website, blog, combo stuff called missmatters.com. It's really to put together older mentors and younger women. So a lot like Aviva online, and create a forum online for women to talk and tell their stories. She does kind of the send in questions and she'll answer that, but once a month she brings in a mentor from out in the world and a bunch of different professions to sort of talk about what it is to be a woman in the marketplace or dating or anyways, it's really, really, really cool what she's doing. So.
And much like we've been talking about Aviva, which different volunteers bring their different skills, the thing about Miss Matters is there's women from very different walks of life. So if a question comes in that someone that's kind of already on her sort of in her bank of mentors is equipped to answer, she doesn't wing it. She hands it to someone who's kind of walked that road, which I think is what kind of distinguishes it from a lot of other advice sites.
Yeah, yeah.
and kind of underscores the point that everybody can do something. Like, she's using what's in her wheelhouse, and she's roped in other people using what's in their wheelhouse. Now, what you want to do, according to your Twitter account, is that it says you are a wannabe cowboy and martial artist. How much do you want to be those things, and what are you doing to achieve those dreams?
I've been going, the cowboy part, I ride horses a fair amount, and I went to a dude ranch in Montana about 15 years ago on a family vacation. We realized we needed outdoor activities and somebody else to do the cooking for us to have a chance of not killing each other. And so we found this place in Montana, which I absolutely fell in love with, and immediately said to them, like, look, if you guys ever need help, I'll be there. And they looked at me like, sure, California kid, yeah, we need your help. But over the years, I've been going back a lot, and that, so I still say wannabe, because the level of skill the people I've met out there have is just mind-blowing. The martial arts I've been doing for about 17 years, and there's a little more, I'm a little less of a wannabe with that one now. Yeah, so some progress.
All right, an occasional bee?
Occasional, yeah.
Partial bee.
My teacher said the other day, you're almost ready to have a white belt. And this is...
Wow. That's pretty impressive, yeah. Maury.
I'm bad.
I do want to end on a serious question. Several years ago, you had the chance to work with some of Hollywood's finest canine talent in Beverly Hills Chihuahua. Yay! Who do you think would be more likely to pee on a set? Any of those dogs or Mandy Patinkin?
Mandy. So there's a table read for Homeland, and it was the pilot, and a lot of the actors weren't there, so I got to read a bunch of, you know, Max doesn't talk very much, so I got to read a bunch of other parts, and we finished it, and I was heading to the restroom, and Mandy was heading to the, well, I was leaving, heading to the restroom, and Mandy was walking by me, and it was my chance to say, you know, Mr. Patinkin, you're amazing, you blow me away, and you're blah, blah, blah. And what I didn't realize is we were both heading to the restroom. So one of my greatest moments was being complimented by Mandy Patinkin while... I just timed it just right.
That is incredible.
It was amazing.
That's
the most inspirational.
So that's what I'll tell the girls. It's those
tonight.
Moments. That,
yeah. It is. That's. I think that would turn a lot of lives around right there.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we want to bring out Katie for a minute here to get set up and move on to our next portion. We are so glad to have you here. We wish you well in everything you do, from your acting career to your martial art belt. And playing on horses and whatever you do. We just wish you the most success in the world, because we're so glad to have you here tonight. So just success with everything except for this game, because it is rigged. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to play
The Game Is Rigged.
Just keep in mind that you won't win, but losing should never cause you shame, because you
Maury, I think we should probably go ahead and address the elephant in the room, which is, you are a good-looking straight white male. Has that been difficult for you? Do you find a lot of doors just aren't open because of that?
I didn't see that one coming. I thought we were going to move past that for the white belt deal. Safe. It's been breezy. Yeah. Thanks.
Just like becoming a famous actor. It's just
nothing but
open doors and glory.
Yeah, open doors and glory,
okay.
No difficulties.
Well,
it's pretty much, it is. That is true. It's society.
Well, we still think you're very brave and a trooper. And we wanted to make you feel better about everything you've had to overcome as you're a member of your very oppressed demographic.
Right.
Letting you know that there are jobs, certain jobs, historically, for which it has been good to be a man. Particularly a white straight man, but definitely not a woman.
So we created a game called It's Good to Be These, set to the music of It Sucks to Be Me from Avenue Q. And for this game, Katie is going to sing to you about some traditionally male-dominated jobs, and your job is to guess what job she is singing about. So, for example, if Katie sang,
I run the country, a job that gives me gray hair. I have an oval office and an awesome swivel chair. I'm who you call on when you've got a war to declare. Then I go sell it to Congress. It's good to be me.
Dick Cheney.
Yes. Correct. You would say president.
President.
Because
yes,
Katie was singing
president.
About the
president
of America.
Now that you've got an idea of how this game is played, it is time to ask you to make your wager. Now keep in mind, you will not win because the game is rigged.
Yes. So you understand the game is rigged. Correct?
I do. I think I'm still feeling pretty good about my chances.
I mean, no matter how well you do, and we do want you to do your best, you cannot win. We want to make this clear.
Remember the demographic.
Traditionally a winning demographic, yes. But knowing that you will lose however much you wager, how much are you willing to wager that you will win?
I will wager $100 that I will win.
$100. Fantastic. Thank you very much. All right, so you understand how the game works?
Yes.
And that you'll lose?
No, yes. Well, I appreciate it. Yeah.
Here we go. Take it away, Katie.
When things are burning, we rush in with the big hose. We flash our lights and make sure the blaring siren goes. We pose for calendars while wearing very few clothes. It's fun to slide down a pole when you're one of these.
I would say fireman.
Fireman is correct. Good job. Yay! Good job. And now for 10 points. You have 10.
Nice.
I'm just going to spend a minute thinking about those calendars. Number two, here we go.
We make our fortunes at Merrill, Morgan, and Saks. We use your money to get regulators off our backs and to defend ourselves from vicious but true attacks that we destroy the economy. It's good to be these.
Stockbroker.
Correct. Very good. That's
very good.
Correct.
You are on a roll.
That's another 10 points. You're doing very well. You're on a roll. All right, number three. Keep it going.
First we yell action, then actors play out the scene. Then a year later, our work is on the silver screen. When it's awards time, our eyes fill with a gleam. Because we won 88 of 89 Oscars in this category.
I'd say actor, specifically, potentially male actor.
That would be incorrect. This is the person who yells action.
Oh, director. I'm
that
sorry.
Is
yes,
correct.
Yes,
yes,
yes.
88 of 89 Oscars.
Yes, right. Yes, yes.
Men. So that's going to be an 8 because you needed a hint.
Okay.
All right. Just keep it rolling. You're doing great. Okay. You might have a chance. You don't have a chance, but you might have a chance.
We've all got fun names like Zynga, Sploosh, and Kapow. We've built the apps, so we're off to get some money now. And we'll make millions even with no revenue stream.
Startup.commerce.
I'm sorry. The answer we were looking for was Silicon Valley startups seeking venture capital, and we did need the exact words.
Exact words. We needed the exact words. So that is wrong, and like every app ever invented, that was worth a billion points, so that's going to be minus one
but that was, there was like
billion.
Yeah, but those were 10, and then you got the 8, which was already
75. Because it's Silicon Valley. It's worth more. Look, there's one more question, Maury. You have a chance.
Okay. No,
could,
cool.
You could win it all
you
back.
Could rally.
You won't, but you
okay,
could.
Okay, I'm going to rally.
You could
rally.
Give it your all. Let's see. All right, final question. Here we go.
When folks stay up late, like past 11 o'clock, Luhr, Jimmy, Other, John, Jack, Chevy, Charlie, and Tom, Chris, Larry, Trevor, Colbert, Bill, Craig, or James, but please swear it's never Reddit, Amy, Tina, Sarah, Sam, Aisha, Maya, Margaret, Tig, Yvette, Natasha, Wanda, Chelsea, or the other Amy, Jessica, the third good Amy, get the hit, but not the ladies. When it comes to these.
Male, average age between 35 and 55,
sure.
Late night talk show hosts.
Correct. And yet, so fundamentally incorrect in its reality, we cannot offer points for it.
We have to award you just a low guttural noise for that. So, minus a billion plus grr. I'm sorry, Maury, but you did not win, and you will be donating that money to Aviva. But I hope you don't feel too badly, because after all, the game was rigged.
Lost the senior paper prize. The never felt so nice. Your reputation bears no stain, because your loss is Aviva's gain.
Ladies and gentlemen, Maury's been a great sport. Let him hear it.
So, now, if you think you can do better than Maury and at minus a billion who couldn't, now's your chance. We have 5 bonus questions for anyone who is willing to wager their own money to guess. We're going to come out into the audience, and you just have to shout out how much you're willing to wager.
And keep in mind that you will lose it, and then also keep in mind that Aviva can take credit card donations, so feel free to wager the maximum amount of debt a bank will issue you. Do I hear $10,000? Get the lights up on the house. Would anyone like to shout out a wager and play a bonus question? Or not?
$5.
Yes. How much?
Five.
$5. That's it's a wager.
Yay.
All right. One moment. I don't know why I keep talking into this like it's working, but it makes me feel safe. Hello, welcome to the show. What's your name?
Veronica.
Hello, Veronica. Are you having a good time?
Yes.
All right. Thank you for wagering $5. Here is your question.
People love sports teams to cheer them on is great fun. Behind the athletes, if you look for women, you'll find none. In the NBA, MLB, NHL, or football. Cause only men know things. It's good to be these.
What's your guess?
A coach.
That is correct. Woo! You have lost $5.
All right.
Make a wager. Yes, sir. Thank you. What is your name, sir?
My name's Brian.
Welcome, Brian. How much would you like to wager?
I'm going to wager $20.
Yeah. $20. All right. Fantastic. Take it away, Katie.
We write the codes for fake battles and quests. The men are heroes. The women all have giant breasts. Real life complaints from ladies make us super distressed.
Okay, thank you. All right. Hello, welcome.
Hello.
What's your name?
Diana.
Thank you so much for being here, Diane. How much would you like to wager that you can lose this question?
How would you feel?
Wonderful. You can come back again. All right. Here's your question.
We save the world in capes and tight-fitting suits. Some wear bright spandex, others prefer iron boots. Stories of origin help get us back to our roots. Our films make billions of dollars. It's good to be these.
What did you get?
Superheroes.
Correct. A viable job choice. $50. Thank you so much. And last one, who wants to bring it home with a big finale? Yes, ma'am? Why, look, it's our co-founder, Annalia Arnold. Hey, thank you so much for being here. How much would you like to wager?
I'll also wager $50.
Wonderful. Woo-hoo. All right. The big finale. Here we go.
We see the cosmos and wonder where we can go. We form big theories about the things that we don't know, but male to female, still a lopsided ratio. Land has been for a brief history of time. That last line's a clue. It's good to be these.
I'm so nervous. I hope I get it right.
That is correct. Yeah, we wouldn't accept any kind of business. So thank you for moving.
Chance to play, Aviva's going to have a table in the lobby after the show where you can see about volunteering or make a donation, and they will be able to take cash, checks, or credit cards.
So if you did lose your money, make sure you go lose it to them at their table.
Make it official.
Thanks, you guys. That's our show.
Thank you so much to Katie McGlynn, Jodi Miller, Elizabeth Warren, Anna Watkins, my co-host, Kate Luhr, Maury Sterling.
And my co-host, Jill Weinberger. Make sure that you like us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, or sign our email list in the lobby to get updates on the next great show. And have a great night. Thanks for being here.
Yes, I agree. It was awesome. Go, go, go.